Very nice. Elvis sent part of his car to see us. Here's the partial table. There's Annie or Anna. Wave.
Set them up. You go with her. She's gonna walk with me. She's gonna walk with you.
She walks in front of me. She walks in front of me.
When you walk down the aisle?
No. Yeah. Maid of honor. And this man said to him, he comes up with you in the front.
I don't think anybody's supposed to walk with you.
She doesn't walk with me. My dad walks with me. She walks in front of me.
Here this evening. I've met most everyone. I'm James Fountain. I'm Jim's number one dad. Right, son? Yes. So we want to welcome everyone here this evening in this joyous occasion. We're excited about things. What we're going to do is first, obviously, we're going to eat. And then we're going to have a time of, y'all come on in. We're going to have a time of sharing and blessing on Jim and Deborah. So we're looking forward to that time we're going to have. Y'all going in here or there or there? Okay, I want to ask first, is Pastor Shane, if you'll come up and pray a blessing on this evening. And pray for our food. We know it's going to be great, right, Jim? Jim's menu.
He didn't tell me I'll do this, and I'm not long-winded when I pray for food. Lord, I just thank you for this fellowship that you've given us. Father, I thank you for this relationship you've allowed us to be a part of.
I'm going to go to the next one.
To have you here, friends, with us.
Kill the band.
Okay. But it is a joy for friends and family to be here. We're excited about y'all being part of this evening. I want to introduce a few people to you. I can't introduce everybody, but I want to introduce the folks up here at the front table. Of course, my wife, Jim's number one mom, my wife, Dee. And of course, and then Jim, the groom, and Deborah. You wonder why I got notes for her, huh? Let's see here. Dr. Gene Rudd, who is Deborah's dad, and Gay Rudd, who is Deborah's mom. St. Clair Cadell.
You can spell that S-I-N or S-T.
As long as you call him sir. And this is Gay's dad, that's right. And this is Dr. Rudd's mother, Esther Rudd, and she's right across the state line of
Greenville, South Carolina.
So we're happy that y'all are here. Of course, Jim's grandmother, Dee's mother, Janice Johnson. Pastor Shane's date, of course. Next to him is Pastor Shane. How do you go to Pastor Shane's church? This is a joy that he's a part of our evening this evening. His wife is at a church shower for a wedding shower.
Baby shower.
So that's why she's not here, but she'll be at the wedding bar. And Shane, we just blessings on you, and we're thankful that you're here with us this evening. And of course, then Jim's granddaddy, Dee's dad, Dr. Ben Minish. And then, of course, a family friend, Linda Cave, who's got the baby back here in the back that belonged to Dee's brother. At the back of the room here, we've got a table. We'll make sure everybody looks at the table. This is some pictures of Jim and Deborah when they were growing up. And, of course, Tracy and Kelly, I know you've recognized some of those shots of Jim when he was young, when he was 5 or 6 years old, when he body slammed him down and tried to kill him. So that's what he looked like then. That's what happened to Jim, I guess. I don't know what happened to him. But make sure y'all get around to taking a minute and look at those before you leave. I think it's just real good. We appreciate y'all doing it. And, of course, Deborah's wedding picture here. It sure is beautiful, and we appreciate Dr. Rudd and Ms. Rudd sharing that with us this evening. And, of course, Elvis sent us a portrait, too. You notice Elvis's Cadillac wing. So Elvis is still alive. You know, I want to tell a little story, and I was thinking, what kind of story should I tell? And I thought I'd tell a Bible story. I got a good Bible story. I went to a meeting in North Carolina, and Dee gave me a book and said, hey, be sure you tell this story here. And so I'm not much on remembering things. As you see, I had to give everybody's name tags. So I'm going to read it here if I have to. But this is back when Adam was on earth. And one day Adam told God, he was moping around. And God said, Adam, what's wrong? And he said, I'm just lonely. I'm just lonely. I've got nobody to talk to. And God said, I can take care of that. I'm going to get you somebody. And we're going to call her a woman. And she's going to be your friend and your partner. And of course, Adam said, a woman? He said, what's a woman? Oh, God said, a woman is so precious. I tell you, she'll keep you company. She'll hold your hand. She'll cook for you.
Yeah.
And when you start wearing clothes, she'll take care of your clothes for you. And Adam thought, man, this sounds good. I like that. And he went on to say, not on that, she'll never nag you. None. Not one single time.
That was from where?
And when you fuss, she'll hug you around the neck and say, honey, you was right all the time. You know, by the time Adam was just having fits and man, sign me up. I may walk toward them. No, that's not any way. Take that back. And went further saying, and not only that, she'll never complain of a headache. She'll have a lot of passion for you. She'll show you some real loving. Then when your youngest come along, you'll never have to get up in the middle of the night. She'll do that for you. She'll do it all for you.
Oh,
and old Adam said, God, that sounds good. What's one of that cost? God said, it's going to cost you an arm and a leg. And Adam looked at him and said, well, God, what can I get for a rib? Jim, all I got to say is this. If Adam had known what we know and didn't know today, we'd be a bunch of one-armed, peg-leg men. Oh, okay. That's pretty good, right?
Yeah. Right on, right on.
But we want those of you who will come up and share a short story or about Jim or Deborah, and maybe come up and share a blessing, or come up and just give a toast. We got a little bit of time before we want to break up tonight. But Jim first and Deborah, you know, I want to just toast. This, by the way, I guess you know is a sparkling grape juice. So there's no misunderstanding. We don't use fermented here. But you know, Jim and Deborah, I just wish y'all a long, happy life. Just God's blessing upon your life. And I know God's just going to bless you wonderfully. And bless you with lots of children. Grandchildren, us. Great grandchildren, others.
Quiver
Jim and Deborah, congratulations.
Yeah. Yeah, right on.
You're here. Dave?
Yeah.
Come out. I'm going to take my notes with you because I know somebody want to steal this story. It's all mine.
Nice.
Those of you who are parents know what I've been feeling the last few weeks to have my first child getting married and doing things like going through old photographs and, you know, getting the pictures out when he was little. And it just seems like it was just last month that Jim was standing up in the crib when I'd go in the mornings. I can't look at him, I'll cry. And I'd say, good morning, sunshine. Or just last week that Jim was running around in his short pants that had cowboys on them, and he had his cowboy boots on, and he always wore that Superman cape.
Yeah. He wore that last night.
Just yesterday that he got his first pair of pump-up tennis shoes and took them to bed with him. Put them up on the bunk bed so he could sleep with them at night. He was so excited, those pump-up tennis shoes. They grow up so fast, it's hard to believe that I have a child getting married already. Deborah, I want to welcome you into our family. We're so excited and so blessed to have you join our family. And Jim, I'm just so proud of you and love you so much. And I just wish y'all a lot of joy, many, many years of happiness.
You're here. Dr. Rudd and Ms. come next. We need to come up so we get you in the video.
Well, since James established the precedent, I think I will continue it. I want to thank James and Dee for hosting the evening. It's been special for us. We also want to thank you for sharing your son into our family. We appreciate that very much. And Jim, I spent about a year and a half trying to run you off. don't think it personally, it'd have been anybody.
It'd be now.
Now it's fairly obvious I'm not going to be successful. So you're very welcome. Welcome in our home all the time. And into the family as a son. Appreciate that. Well, James, indeed, we have gotten our children in some kind of a pickle here. And I guess God's going to have to get them out of it. They're in love with one another, and they want to be with one another. And probably the only solution to that is marriage. Now, I was thinking back after what you were talking about Adam and Eve, and I'll pull out an Adam and Eve story. It's about children and how children do get out of control and do strange things. And even God was not able to extend his omnipotence into his own children. It's a story about Adam and Eve. After creating heaven and earth, God created Adam and Eve. And the first thing he said was, don't. Don't what? Adam replied. Don't eat the forbidden fruit, God said. Forbidden fruit? We have forbidden fruit? Hey, Eve, we've got forbidden fruit. No way. Yeah, way. God, do not eat the forbidden fruit. Why? Adam said. Because I'm your father and I said so, God replied, wondering why he hadn't stopped creation after he made the elephants. Just a few minutes later, God saw his children having an apple break, and he was ticked. Didn't I tell you not to eat the fruit, God said, the first parent, he asked. Uh-huh, Adam replied. Then why did you, said God. I don't know, said Eve. She started it, Adam said. Did not, did too, did not. Having had it with the two of them, God's punishment that he decided for Adam and Eve was that they should have their own children. Thus the pattern was set and to be continued. But rest assured, there is a pleasant ending to the story, and if you've persistently and lovingly tried to give wisdom to your own children, and I have, and they haven't taken it, and you haven't. Just remember that God had trouble with his own children, his own first children. There's a lot of little quips here about children. Just a couple of them was that grandchildren, James, indeed, there is some hope here. Grandchildren are God's reward for not killing your own children. Mothers know why some animals eat their young. The main purpose for holding children's parties is to remind yourself that there are children more awful than your own. One couple said that they had child-proofed their home for the last 3 years, but they were still getting in. And just this last one, a healthy reminder for us parents here. We need to be nice to these kids because they're the ones be choosing our nursing homes. When Deborah was about 12, I suppose, we went away one day and I talked to her about not birds and bees, but actually caterpillars and butterflies. And I was telling her that as she was developing into a young woman, and I saw her changing from that caterpillar to butterfly, that I was going to remind her of that from time to time. And you know I have from time to time. I call you a caterpillar, and sometimes I call you a butterfly. Well, I suppose as of tomorrow, I'll always have to call you a butterfly, because you're going to be flying away, no longer in your cocoon, and you blossom into a beautiful butterfly. Your mother and I love you. Appreciate you. But Jim, I need to warn you. There is a past here. Deborah was the most difficult child for us to manage. And I say that with all seriousness. She was much more of a challenge for us. She has a wonderful personality, but she just has a zest for life that our boys, that got her into trouble that our boys didn't quite have. I remember when we brought her home from the hospital, the first 6 months, I really wanted to give her back. She was the most demanding child, Jim. The most demanding child. But from 6 months to 2 years, it got pretty good. It really did. Those were real precious years. 2 years? No, I don't know. But there's some good times in there. You're going to have to remember that. There will be some good times and some hard times. But I'll tell you something else about Deborah and probably all women, how they view marriage and that wedding ceremony. They think about walking down that aisle, they think about kneeling at the altar, they think about Him. Walking down the aisle, kneeling at the altar, and Him. The aisle, the altar, Him. Aisle, altar, Him. I had a psychology teacher who taught us something about marriage, and she always used to say that marriage was a fine institution if you didn't mind living in an institution. But we know that God makes marriages in heaven, and we believe this one was made in heaven, but the responsibility for upkeep is yours.
Amen.
And we brought you an owner's manual. Put your names on it. And we want you to keep this marriage well kept. We do believe it's made in heaven, but it's going to be your responsibility. We can't divorce ourselves from our responsibilities either as loving parents and maybe grandparents one day. So we're going to be there rooting for you the whole way, praying for you, holding you before the Lord. That's our job. But your job is to keep that marriage well kept too. And we got you an owner's manual to do that. The Bible, it's got your Jim and Deborah fountain on the front. I had some other comments, but for the sake of the other people having a chance to speak, I'll pass over them. When I worked in Russia, my Russian friends taught me a toast in Russian. And the toast is Da Zdorovya. It means a little bit more in depth than just to your health. It means the health of you totally, spiritually, mentally, physically. And I guess if we were to modify that and take a little bit of a spiritual twist to that or develop something from the scripture on that, it would probably be the passage that the Apostle John wrote, the third letter, the second verse. He said, brothers, above all things, I wish that you would prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. And I'll modify that, paraphrase a little bit, and say, Jim and Deborah, above all things, your parents wish that you would prosper, be in health, total health. Prospering not financially is not the way that word means. It's prosper totally and being health totally, just as your soul prospers. And that's our prayer for you. So, Da Zdorovya.
Let me pull this back down for a short, people. Let's continue with this table here. Would anyone else come like to share a story or a toast, one of the grandparents, or Shane? Come and share a brief.
Could I share from right here?
Yes, sir, you may.
I'm thinking back about 25 years ago when a young medical student came seeking the hand of my precious young daughter, Brenda Gay. And she was my heartthrobs. The other children, if they wanted Grandpa to do anything, they sent this little one to ask Grandpa because he couldn't say no. And anyway, Dr. Rudd was such a gentleman, you know, he came and paid me a nice visit and talked to me and asked for the hand of my daughter in marriage. And you know, I was sort of a slow learner. And what I was thinking about was losing a daughter that had brought such joy to our home. But I told him, you know, I just can't express exactly how I feel, and I don't believe you'll ever know how I feel until you have a daughter that you're going to give to another man. But if she's going to get married, I don't know of anybody that I would rather her marry than you. Wasn't that pretty much the conversation? If I tell a lie, you correct me. And I want you to know that I wish I had been smart enough to realize that I was not losing a daughter, but I was gaining a wonderful son. And he's brought nothing but joy and happiness and health and satisfaction to our family. He has truly been a blessing. And I just want to say, you know, sort of how I felt about you. You was honest enough to tell us sort of how you felt about Jim. So I want you to just be patient with old Jim. Old Jim will come through, won't he? Old Jim will make you proud of him. And I tell you, could I do something? Could I ask these grandchildren to stand up? Stand up. I want you to look. Look here. What a blessing. There's one over there. Look at here. Look at here. Isn't it a blessing? Hey! But anyway, Deborah and Jim, we just want to have a little fun. But as he said to you, I want to tell you that my home and my heart is open to you. Anybody that's Deborah's friend is my friend. And I mean that sincerely. And you're always welcome at my house anytime you want to come.
Weed the garden.
Huh? Yeah, weed the garden. I'm looking for some garden help, folks. But Jim and Deborah, we do wish you great happiness, all the happiness that life can bring. And that you'll just stay together. There'll be good times and difficult times. But by working together, putting God first in your life and following Him, He'll see you through every difficulty. And life can truly be wonderful, can't it, folks? Bless every one of you. Here you. Here's to Jim and Deborah. Right on.
Thank you, Miss Sinclair.
Well, I'm the grandmother. I'm the big mama. That's what they call me. And Deborah's my only granddaughter, and I love her very much, and I'm going to love Jim just the same. And they've both been in my home, well, together. Deborah's been in there for years. But Jim has started coming to my home, what, about a year ago, I think, Kevin. And I fed him, too. And so anytime you want to come, you're just welcome, both of you. And I'll feed you.
Thank you, Gabe. Deborah,
yeah. Jim will go everywhere, anywhere, somebody will feed him when you see him.
Yeah.
Okay, Dana, you care to share?
Yes. Well, I want to tell different parents something that happened to me, and I'm sure it has happened to them too. But the first day that Dee brought James home to meet us, the way he looked at my daughter, I knew he was going to steal her and take her away. And it was very, very sad to lose your first daughter. But I'll have to admit, he has been a perfect husband, perfect father, and I will keep him forever. And I think Jim, when he came in my door, brought Deborah to meet me, I saw the same look on his face. And I thought, no, it'll never happen. But it did, and all I want to tell you is, Jim has great parents, and he should respect her the same way and treat her really nice, and I think he will really enjoy it.
Thank you. Okay.
I'd like to share one of the first times that I sat down and seriously talked to these two. I've been the one that's kind of know that y'all, most of y'all are the family and stuff. I've been the one that's kind of watched them since when they just started to like each other and they started to hang out. And you'd watch them in the church. They start to sit together during service and supposed to be having praise and worship. And she's watching him play the guitar and telling my sound person to turn the guitar up because I can't hear Jim loud enough. I remember sitting down. I can't remember what it was, but I had to sit down. I had to talk to them about something, about a relationship or something. It was just a very small thing, but I just sat down, and before I ever got into it, it was kind of confronting, trying to say, you know, we need to do it this way, and they've always been in ministry. And before I even got started, Deborah just started to cry, just bawl and cry. And I looked at her, I said, Deborah, why are you crying? She says, I have no idea. I don't know why I'm crying. I looked at Jim, I says, is this normal? Oh, he says, oh, yes, this is very normal. And I asked him, I says, how you doing? I just normal. I says, Jim, you are probably definitely the man that God has for this woman. Because he just took everything in stride. I can say for this couple that have a young church, and I see a lot of couples, and I feel like as a pastor, I kind of look out for their well-being. And it's almost like everybody that knew them knew that they were going to be together forever from the very, very first time they started. Kind of the look you're talking about in their eyes. But I'll tell you something that my father-in-law told me when I went to go ask for her hand, my wife's hand. He says, this isn't Walmart, there is no returns. He says, you can't bring her back. He said, there's no malfunction guarantee, there's no warranty. But I can tell you this, that I went through, that my wife was Spanish, and I was the first white person into the family. And she was the oldest. And I came and I asked for her hand, and it was a Spanish culture, which is a very, very tight culture. And my father-in-law did not welcome me into the family. But as of today, we are best friends. As of today, he pastors for me. And I could just encourage all the families. I know that y'all haven't spent a lot of time together, but when two families come together as this, especially as a minister I've watched, that you're not losing people. And I can say this with all my heart now as I have a little baby daughter, and I look at my baby daughter, and I look at her, and I think about Deborah, and I says, no destiny, you're not going to get married. No destiny, you're not dating until you're 30. I told my youth pastor, we're not having co-ed youth groups when she's a teenager. We have separated youth groups. So I'm starting to, in the last 6 months, I'm starting to understand. But I just thank y'all for the privilege to be able to watch after their souls, and that they truly have, that Jim truly has been a man of God ever since I've known him, and has treated this woman as a man of God, and that this young lady, Deborah, has been a woman of God the entire time I've known her, and that this relationship has been a tribute in my church of relationships and how they can grow, how they can properly work, how they can properly be together. And I say that now publicly because it's a tribute to the mothers, the fathers, the grandfathers, and grandmothers of how y'all raised y'all's daughters and y'all's son. And I just toast you right now, and I bless you. I bless you with spiritual growth, revelation, and signs and wonders. Amen.
All right, Benjamin, you got the...
Well, I just toast them to total success in their life. That means just financial, Dr. Brett said.
Amen. All right. Well, I'm going to go sit down. We've got a few minutes. I would like those who'd like to come up and share. Story I know a lot of you folks do, so if y'all come on and get started, I'd like to call you up, okay?
Yeah, well, since I was late for the rehearsal, I guess I'll have to be
nice. Now, let's keep these about a minute, please.
Yeah, see how I judge time, right?
Go, man.
Anyhow, yeah, Mr. Fountain told me I better get over here and say something good. Yeah, and he was also blaming me on Jim and Deborah getting together. And I guess I can take a little responsibility for that, because I left in the spring of 99, and Deborah came down in fall of 2000, I believe. Or do I have that? Fall of 99. I left spring of 99. And, you know, Jim and I were good friends, and we'll talk about that a little bit here. But, yeah, I told Jim, well, just look after my sister, you know? she's been out here, like me, who got to go down with my cousin. She was coming down without killing anybody and all, but... Yeah, Jim, he took real good care of her. Looks like he will be for the rest of their life. I'm happy about that. Anyhow, yeah, I just wanted to say a little bit about Jim. Like I said, we both started school down there at the same time. And, you know, there's like certain people you meet, and just right away you know that they're an exceptional person. They're a different person. I'm happy to say a lot of the folks sitting here, you know, are also... great and exceptional people. but yeah, Jim, he stuck out. And he came up to live in Wellens the second year I was there. And those of you who know me know that I didn't get outside of Wellens very much. So I got to get to know him a lot better then. And he did one of the kindest things for me that anyone ever had. I don't know, it just really affected me. What it was is every time a fall break or spring break would come around. Carlos and I would always load up his little car with all our computer equipment, and we had lots of it. And I had this one great big 21-inch monitor. This thing weighed like 90 pounds. And every time he came along, I dreaded carrying that thing out of the car. Just hated it. And I loved having it with me, you know? It's one of those love-hate things. Anyhow, I was carrying stuff out, and I'm getting ready to go back inside, and I look up, here's Jim and Ben carrying that great big monitor down the stairs for me. And that just really meant a lot to me at the time. And yeah, so I can say unequivocally, Jim, you're a great guy, you know. And out of all these people, I'd say you're probably the one I'd want marrying my sister. how am I such an expert on exceptional people? Well, I'll tell you. It's because I grew up with a bunch of them. And Deborah, you definitely fit the role there too. And I'm so proud of you and many of the things you've done. Your exceptional work ethic, your intelligence. I'm proud to have you as a sister. And proud to have Jim as a brother-in-law. So, thank you.
Man.
Actually the summer after my first year there at Emmanuel, and because he didn't live in a dorm in Wellens that first year. And I got to know him on a ministry team that summer when we went on a trip to Arkansas. And our relationship, it was never platonic because we got to know each other and we related to each other spiritually because we were on the ministry team. And so right off the bat, we were relating each other on a spiritual level, sharing things with each other because we had to, as far as accountability goes on the ministry team. And at the end of that trip, we kind of just looked at each other, and it's almost like simultaneous. We said, "Hey, we ought to be roommates." We just kind of looked at each other. We were like, "Okay." So, and we were together 2 years, which is usually that's actually an exception, I believe, in Wellens, 2 years together with one person, but. That time with Jim especially changed my life, and I want to share that with him. That's what I'm going to focus on. He was chaplain up there, and Jim has, you know, been sort of a quiet person, quiet demeanor, but I know his sly, devious ways sometimes. What stuck out to me about him was his consistency in his relationship with God, and how he was never flashy with his faith. There was no false facade with it, no flamboyance, no outward put on at all about his faith. And that really did change my life. And you'll never know how much God used you to show things in my life. And I mean, you can see you can see a preacher every Sunday, you can get up there and speak, and it'll be great. But when you live with a person, for 2 years I lived with you, every day was an impression. God used you to impress something in my heart. And I just looked at Jim, and God just said, now look at that. You know, that's something you can take, and that's something you can live with. You know, that's something you can live with. And so I just wanted to thank Jim for putting up with me for 2 years, and for just showing me so much about God and about living a life that is truly based on faith and a true, pure relationship with God. And also, Deborah, I really liked you when I was really happy for you, because Jim was like my brother, and I was so happy when I met you. You know, I thought you were a perfect match for Jim. And I was so happy that you guys were together and getting married. And I just want to wish just blessings on you. I know God has wonderful things in store for both of you. God is going to use you powerfully. So.
Jim, but no more two-year roommates.
You ruined everything.
That's right.
No refunds.
Next.
I'll shift gears here a little bit. I don't have any real in-depth history with Jim. I'm not an Emmanuel College alumnus or anything like that. I'm a product, me and my wife are a product of outreach at Freedom Point. And almost as soon as I started going to Freedom Point, I was asked to be on the praise and worship team. And probably the first person on that team that I really bonded with was Jim. And one of the things that initially stuck out to me was Jim's love of God. It's very apparent. And I don't know the guy's name that was right before me. I'm sorry, dude. But, you know, Jim's never been really a flashy person. But, you know, I play guitar in close proximity to Jim. And I see the intricacy of some of the stuff he plays on that guitar. Some of the expressions on his face, you know, and we play some crazy music sometimes. It gets far out there, it's an adventure, you know. There's high points and low points, and, you know, Jim, that's kind of the way life is. And that's the way a lot of marriages are. Sometimes you're going to be as high as you know, ever been, and sometimes you'll be as low as you ever been, you know. But pay as much attention to detail with your wife as you do playing that guitar sometimes, and y'all are gonna make some beautiful music together. I've never known Jim and Deborah separately. From the minute I knew Jim, I knew Deborah. You know, it's basically kind of like the same person, two sides of the same coin. You know, and they're both real genuine people. I think they're matched for each other, and one of the most perfect ways, you know, because the blessing of God is definitely on you two. And I just wish you, from me and my wife, I wish the two of you a long and fruitful marriage, and make your parents proud, have a few kids.
Amen.
Ain't that simple to it.
Godsend roommate, because I don't know, I'm Paul's roommate for my first semester of college and hers too. And all that summer I had been praying that I get the right roommate, because if you don't have the right roommate, you're just not going to have a good time. So, I was praying very intently that I would have somebody that was normal.
God, do something.
Well,
so I was saying.
I get this letter in the mail that says, you know, you're living in this dorm and this roommate. So I get there and I go to my dorm room and they're like, no, you're not in this dorm. And I was like, what? And they're like, this isn't your roommate either. Or you have somebody else. So I did, and I went to my room and I found it, and my roommate wasn't there yet. She wasn't. She'd be coming in later on. And so we went to orientation and everything, and I remember distinctly sitting in this room, orientation, and I see Deborah walk in with somebody else. I don't think I've told you this. And I was like, there's just something about her. I really want to get to know her. And so later on, we ended up, we started talking, and then we're like, why don't we just room together? And so we did. We kicked the other girl out of my room. We made her move into the other room, and she was my roommate. So it was but I said we did not get a bit of studying done that first semester. We usually end up sleeping or ghetto dancing to praise and worship. and then comes along Jim, and me and Deborah spend a lot of time together, and then Jim comes along and we start taking all these walks, and I'm like,
I really didn't know him.
Yeah, I wanted to say. I should be gone frequently, and I was like, don't worry. And so she was like, oh, this guy's so nice and stuff. And but eventually, you know, it something more became of it, and Deborah became a person that I looked up to spiritually, and I wanted to see her respect for Jim and how much she respected him, and how much he loved her. He was her leader. And Debbie, you'll never know when over those times that I was just down. You gave me strength. Well, thank you so much. Thank you, Jim. I'm so glad that y'all are together, because y'all can pull me up sometimes. So thank y'all so much. I love you.
I remember some little things that one of the first memories I have of Deborah was when she was just a little baby. And well, I remember when she was born, but aside from that, and they were visiting at our house from wherever they were living at the time. I think maybe it was Hawaii. And they were visiting at our house, and Deborah was old enough that she was getting into stuff, and Gene was trying to stop her from getting into something, and she was getting into it anyway, and so he gave her a couple little swats kind of reluctantly, and I don't think it had the effect on her that he wanted it to have, because she reached up her little hand and touched his face and gave the cutest little baby wiggle you've ever heard. But all Gene could do was just roll his eyes. But I remember some, you know, sadder times when Gene and my dad passed away, and Deborah was at that age when it just wasn't making sense to her why, if we're happy for Big Daddy, why are we crying? And so just, I remember her standing in there, and while I was getting ready for the funeral, we were talking about that, and I was explaining things to her about, you know, what I could, and that was just a precious little time. But and then trying to make her understand at whatever age she was that even though I wasn't married, I was still an adult. She had it in her head that I was not an adult until I got married. So here I was in my 20s. It's like, Deborah, I'm really an adult. So I have some precious memories of Deborah, but I wish her and Jim the best.
I got a little story I can tell about James and Dee, and I think the truth should finally come out about this. It's when James first came around the house, the first thing I can remember is he came and we had this big St. Bernard. And Dave brought him and James came over, and the St. Bernard or chase you if you ran from it. So James came over, and he was with Dee, and the St. Bernard attacked him, tore his pants, and broke his glasses. And he thought that it was because of, you know, the dog just did it. But really, Mom and Dad paid me to make that dog attack. I thought James would finally hear the true story.
We didn't have a dog.
And I used to play with Jim a lot when he was little, and Dee and James used to get on to me for coming over and teaching him how to wrestle and giving him great gifts and, you know, made a lot of noise. But the story I remember most about Jim is when I had to babysit Jim and Anna, and Dee and James were coming to a meeting in Atlanta. And they left them over at my house when I lived in an apartment in Atlanta. And so, for some reason, if I got within 2 or 3 feet of Anna, she would start screaming and crying. You know, and I couldn't figure out what was wrong with her. Every time I got near her, I had to stand on the other side of the room for her to be quiet. You know, and Jim is just loving every minute. She just thinks this is the greatest thing in the world. Finally, she just got where she was just screaming bloody murder, and I couldn't get her to stop. I said, Jim, I don't know what to do. I need to call your parents. We don't know where they are. And Jim said, you got to change your diaper. You know, because Anna was real little. So I said, you sure, Jim? Because I had never changed a diaper before. You sure? I really wasn't looking forward to this. And Jim said, yes, it's her diaper. That's why she's crying. So, of course, I take her diaper off. And I said, there's nothing wrong. Jim said, I know. I just wanted to make you do that. But I never could figure out why Anna was screaming around me all the time. And then, Deborah came into the family and started coming and visiting us. And we went and asked Jim and Deborah to go to a ball game with us. And me and my wife were talking about it on the way here, about how quiet Jim was and how quiet Deborah was. You know, Jim's always so quiet. And we took them to this ball game. You know, and Jim is just screaming and hollering, jumping up and down. You know, he's lost control. You know, and then Deborah starts doing it. You know, and this is a big football game for Commerce, and running back was going to break the record and everything. And when they score a touchdown, they throw these balls up in stands. So, I just want to welcome Deborah to the family and everything, but I just want y'all to know I'm not going to let Deborah take my little girl to a football game. Because when they threw one of them balls up in the sand, Deborah, not so distant. This little kid is 6 feet. You know, and he goes over to his mom and crying, and he says, she took my ball. And here's Deborah jumping up and down. She's so glad she could knock her off. They're not always nice and quiet. There is another side.
She gave it to
Mom. After I told her what she did and harassed her enough, she felt guilty and she gave that little kid the ball. On a serious note, I really enjoy being around Jim. I saw him all the time when he was little, and then I got where I didn't see him as much and got to see him a good bit when he went to college. Hope I get to see Anna more now that she's in college. And I just want to wish both of y'all many years of happiness.
Hey.
See, one to talk and one for the translator.
Can you go a little slower?
Okay, I'm Deborah's uncle, and so that you know, here is the connection. That's Deborah, you know Deborah. That's Gay, you know Gay. That's Judy, Gay's sister. That's my wife. And this is, of course, my father-in-law. And when I asked him for her hand, he didn't tell me the same that he...
he is very, very truthful.
So, since this is not the, my stories, but I just can't stop telling you that we've been married for 27 years, very, very happily. And our daughter Clara is 17 years old. So I know about all the tricks. I come from a family of 10 with 5 sisters. So I know all the tricks that were used to keep the boys away from the house. And I knew the tricks that he used, which didn't work. So I know what doesn't work. And I know what he used, which didn't work either. So Clarita, brace yourself, because I know all the tricks. 20 years. Anyway, I'm kind of the outsider of the family. Not only that, but we've lived out of town, you know, to say the least, most of our married life.
Out of town?
Out of country. So I really don't know Jim very well. I know Deborah. And I tell you, Jim, that you are coming into the most wonderful family that you could, anybody could expect to be a member of. I don't know Jim, but I know Deborah, and I know my son Carlos. And every time that I ask about Jim, all I get is the finest guy. Deborah is wonderful. She loves him. They're going to be very, very happy together. And I'm sure that that's going to be like that. So I wish you a lot of happiness from the Isasa part of the family. Now we are the family too, and you know you can count with us for anything, Jim. And since once you start getting a little bit older, you don't lose any opportunity to give a little bit of advice. I just tell you, Jim, remember, it takes two to dance the tango. And if there's anything that I can tell you is never be mad at the same time. Never be mad. And it's very, very easy to be mad when you feel that you are right, that you are righteous. And it's very, very difficult to be humble and quiet when you know that you're right. So remember that. I wish you a lot of happiness. Mucha suerte. Y que Dios nos bendiga.
I think Judy ought to have equal time.
Anna, are you going to play? Here, but I put me on the spot. So, I want to say that I love you, Deborah, and you're awesome, and I'm glad that you're part of my family now. You've always kind of been a part of our family ever since you come, but now you're really part because you're my sister-in-law, and I'm glad that you're going to be coming. So I want to say that I love you, Jim, and I want you to always stay true to God and just keep growing. You're an awesome person. I've always looked up to you. I've always respected you. And you've always taken care of me. And like everyone, they're like, oh yeah, I hate my brother. He's so stupid. I'm like, I love my brother. My brother's good to me. You always take care of me. And then we have like little spats. And that one time I bit you and I broke my little braces things. We had a lot of good times together, and I want you to come visit me at school when I visit you, and when you move off, still come and see me and everything. I just want to say I love you.
Amen. We're going to close this out, but before I do, I want to ask, is anyone just dying? They got to say something before I close it out. Is anyone else just really want to say something before I close? Okay, last chance. This is Deborah's
brother.
Number two brother.
Josh.
Josh.
Well, I've been standing back there thinking about.
That's dangerous.
Especially for him.
I remember lots of memories about them. I remember her stealing my footballs and. and other things, but I love my sister. You know, I really, you know, I'm glad she's getting married to Jim because I think Jim's a really good guy. But you know, I was thinking, and I think me and Jonathan and David have all sat up long nights thinking about Deborah getting married. And what kind of guy Jim is, and we hear Deborah, Jim. And we think, what kind of guy is Jim? And John's like, oh, Jim's a real good guy. Yeah, but I was like, well, you know, I haven't met Jim yet, so I'm just going to wait till I meet him, of course. But, you know, Jim is a real good guy, and I'm glad Deborah's getting married to him, but, you know, me and my brothers are all bigger than you. So, you know, treat my sister good and you'll be all right.
Yeah, like I said, it's been a joy for everybody here. I also want to do something. I want to thank Jim's grandpa, Ben. I know on Jim's behalf, Jim's been in college for 4 years, and Jim always enjoyed going to Grandpa's house, and I know he'd always have a Super Bowl party. Right? And I know a couple years ago, Jim's going to Grandpa's house Super Bowl party, but he says it's just going to be me and Deborah going, because nobody's going to go. They're going to somebody else's house in town. Well, Jim goes to Grandpa's house, and about 30 minutes later, everybody shows up at Grandpa's house. Oh, that was a dog party. We want to go to Jim's Grandpa's house. He's cool. And so that's great. And also, this summer, Jim's had a good time getting to know Royce and his wife, Jackie, and Jimmy and his wife, Teresa. These are cousins of Ben. And one night, Jim came in, he called me on the phone, and he said, Dad, man, I've had the wildest time now. I've been out to the old man's club. I said, what? Yeah, I've been out, this is old man's, and I've been out to old man's club. I said, well, I said, yeah, I went out with them. Of course, Hicks was part of it, Hicks and Lena May, who's not here tonight. Said, that's the funnest crew I've ever been in my life. I love that. So we appreciate y'all coming tonight. And of course, Ben Dean, Jim's great aunt, is here. And Harvey, we really appreciate, that's Ben's sister. We really appreciate y'all coming so much. You know, Jim's been a great son. We're going to close that. Jim's been a great son. And, you know, Jim's only been grounded a few times in his life. And but when he was grounded for life by his mother. So, Jim, we release you from that. Deborah, we're going to release him now. He's under your custody. I'm serious now about him. If he grounded that boy, he's grounded for life. But, Jim, you have been a faithful son. You've been faithful in all your ways. You've been a blessing to your dad and your mom. And, you know, we love you so much. I've written Jim a letter every week since Jim's been in college. And I always say the same thing. Jim, you're a blessing. Your joy and how proud I am of you, Jim, and I am. And Deborah, I'm giving you a son who's been faithful in all his ways. And I present him to the Roots, a son who's been faithful in all his ways. And I'm proud of him. And so I want to toast you and Deborah in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. Congratulations. We thank everybody for coming. Stay as long as you want and visit. But this is officially the end.
Thank you. What time does this thing start, sweetheart?
Before the game, we
put on. Hey, we're 30 minutes early. You're supposed to be recording it. Don't do that close to me. Look at that pretty woman next to Granny. James, I guess you can tell who's got the video recorder. Make sure it's still working.
Here.
I want people there who love me and who want to be there, who are willing to drive me to my hometown to be at.
Thank you.
We have come here together in the presence of God to witness the joining together of this man and this woman in holy matrimony. The sacred relationship of marriage was established by God in creation and our Lord Jesus Christ by his first miracle at the wedding of Cana. The union of a husband and wife in heart, body, and mind is intended by God to be a mutual joy, to help and to comfort, to be given to each other in prosperity and adversity, and when it's God's will, for procreation of children. Therefore, marriage is not to be entered in unadvisedly or lightly, but soberly, deliberately, and in reverent fear of God. In this holy union, Deborah and Jim now come together to be joined. Jim Fountain, will you have this woman to be your wife, to live together in holy covenant of marriage? Will you love her, honor her, keep her in sickness and in health, forsaking all others, being faithful to her as long as y'all both shall live? Deborah, will you have this man to be your husband, to live together in holy covenant of marriage? Will you love him, honor him, keep him in sickness and in health, forsaking all others, being faithful to him for so long as you both shall live?
I do.
Who gives this woman to be married?
The mother.
Lord Jesus Christ told us, in creation, man is made male and female. And for this cause, man shall leave his mother and cleave to his wife and become one flesh. These two have desired and do desire to be joined in this way. Please repeat this after me. I, Jim, take you, Deborah, to be my lawfully wedded wife, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish for all the days of my life. As God is my witness, I give you this promise. I, Deborah, take you, Jim.
I, Deborah, take you, Jim.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poor.
For richer or for poor.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
Love and to cherish.
For all the days of our life.
For all the days of our life.
As God is my witness.
As God is my witness.
I give you this promise.
I give you this promise.
Amen. The word states that love is patient, love is kind, it is not jealous. Love does not brag, love is not arrogant. It is not unbecoming, it does not seek its own. It is not provoked easily. It does not take account of wrong suffered. And it does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices in truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. Having this love in your heart, you have chosen to seal your vows by the giving and receiving of rings. Bless this ring as a sign of covenant, that everybody that would see this would know and understand the covenant that stands between these two. In the name of Jesus, repeat this after me. I give you this ring as a symbol of my vow. And with all that I am and all that I have, I honor you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Bless this ring in the name of Jesus, that it would represent and be a sign to everyone of the Holy Covenant here today. I give this ring as a symbol of my vow. With all that I am.
With all that I am.
And all that I have.
And all that I have.
I honor you.
I honor you.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And the Son. This time, we changed how we rehearsed a little bit. Deborah does not know about this, but at this time, Jim would like to say something special to his bride.
I want to tell you that I love you so much, and I was reading a book before we got married. It said that when you come down to the altar, to get married, you come down the altar and kill your desires and your wants. And I've come down today to give out what I want, what I desire, and to put you first. And I love you so much.
At this time, the fathers would come forward, pray a blessing on these two.
Deborah, Jim, our Heavenly Father now sees you as one. And now your mothers and your fathers see you as one as well. And we want to give you a blessing of peace. Jesus said, I give you peace. I leave you peace. Not as the world gives you peace. We give you a blessing of peace. We give you a blessing of peace because you have chosen to have the Prince of Peace come and be the Savior of your soul. We give you a blessing of peace because you've chosen to have the Prince of Peace be the ruler of your marriage. We give you a blessing of peace because you have chosen the Prince of Peace to be the Lord of today and your tomorrows. We give you a blessing of peace, and it's not a peace that will keep you from storms in life, but it is a peace that will keep you through those storms in life. We give you a blessing of peace, and it's not a peace that will release you from the toils and the strife of life, but it is a peace that will give you an incredible satisfaction in serving the King. We give you a peace that will not keep you too from conflict, but we do give you a blessing of peace. That's a blessing of peace that involves redemption and restoration, a type of peace that honors God and pleases Him. We give you a peace that is made perfect when your minds are stayed on Him. We give you a peace that passes understanding. We give you a peace that restores your soul. We pray a grace, that grace and peace may be multiplied in you and your marriage. And now we pray that the Lord would bless you and keep you, and the Lord would make His face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen.
My son, you're like the fragrance of the field which the Lord has blessed. Therefore, may God give you the dew of heaven, of the fatness of the earth, and plenty of grain and oil. Open your mouth and spread the gospel of Jesus Christ in wisdom, knowledge, and power of God. May you and your household always love God with all your heart. Fear Him and reverence His name. For out of the heart proceeds the issues of life. Jim, maybe you be the man and the husband and the father that God has called you to be. A man called by God to do things of eternal value. A loving, kind, and gentle man, always seeking the face of the Lord. Always be gentle and kind to your wife and children, putting them ahead of all others. Jim, God has blessed you with a God-fearing wife, who is beautiful in spirit, soul, and body. She has a servant's heart, and she will be a teacher in love and admonition of the Lord, imparting special grace to your children. Deborah, may you be blessed as Rachel and Lem, the builders of the household of faith, and be like a fruitful vine in the heart of your house. May your children be as olive plants in the house of the Lord, and as pillars sculptured in love of the Lord and polished with the spirit and glory of God. May the names of you and your family be written in the Lamb's Book of Life.
And you may you be found with faith and faithfulness when the Lord returns. May the zeal, the love, and the power of God always be evident in your life. Jim and Deborah, I bless you with good health. And may God's angel go before you and cause you to succeed. I say blessed to you because you have made Jesus Christ your Lord and God. I love you dearly, and I bless you with my life, my love, and my prayers. I love you, son.
At this time, could the family step forward to lay hands on this marriage to bless them? And I'll pray a prayer of blessing over them. Father, we love you and we come to you through your holy Son, Jesus Christ. And Father, I come to you and I ask that you would bless this marriage. That Father, you would take the two that are standing here and that you would bind them together in such a way that nothing could ever separate them. Father, I ask that you would bind their futures together, that you would take the two visions that you have placed in the hearts and the spirits of these two, and that you would mesh them together, that they would become one. Father, I pray over this man of God right now, that you would show him, mold him, make him, and teach him how to be the man of God of this house, how to be the head of this house, and how to submit to this woman's needs. Father, I ask that you would give this woman a holy anointing, that you would anoint her and enable her to be the woman of God and the wife that you have called her to be to this man. That you would show her how to walk. And Father, I pray over this couple that you would prosper them in everything they do, that you would prosper them in every spiritual venture that they would step out to, that you would prosper them in every financial venture they would step out to, that you would prosper them in their family, that you would prosper them in every relationship that they come in contact with, that you would prosper them in every way of their life. And Father, I ask that every person that is here at this wedding today, that you would put a holy reverence in our hearts, and that you would make us keepers of this covenant. That Father, you would move on our hearts to pray for this covenant. You would move on our hearts to love this covenant. That you would move on our hearts to always build up these two, always look out for these two, to protect and to meet the needs of these two, to be the people that you've raised up to stand behind and to the right and to the left for holy protection over this man and this wife. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Now that Jim and Deborah have given themselves to each other by solemn vows before God as their witness, and have shown their affection through entrusting and giving of rings and joining of hands, I pronounce that they are husband and wife in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You may kiss your wife. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Mr. and Mrs. James Mitchell Fountain IV.
welcome to join us for a reception to celebrate this wonderful marriage.
Say hello.
Hi guys. I'm very happy for both of you and
you're next.
I'm very happy for both of you and I don't know what to say. I hope y'all are very happy together and I really enjoyed your wedding. It was very, very beautiful.
Very good.
She said it all. I agree completely with her. See you later, Deborah. Bye-bye.
Mm. Yeah. Okay, Roxy, what you gonna say to Deborah and Jim?
Oh gosh, something really okay. I told them last night. I love you, Deborah and Jim. Y'all are awesome.
Hey, Deborah and Jim. Deborah, I just wanted to say, last year you made my first year here at Emmanuel just wonderful. And Jim, so did you. And it was just a wonderful wedding. And just so Deborah and Jim. So, I love y'all. Congratulations.
Deborah and Jim, you are beautiful. Deborah, I just want to appreciate you and let you know how wonderful you are and how your good advice and insight have helped me. Have fun, y'all.
Say something.
Hey.
Great Jim and Anna. Deborah.
Deborah and Anna. Hey. I love you guys and I'm glad you're finally married. It's just weird, but I was just and glad you're married.
Okay, Ann, you're next.
Well, it's Jim and Deborah. Yeah. It's an awesome wedding. You both look beautiful. Have a great honeymoon and we'll see you when you get back. Yeah. Love you, bye.
You're so pretty.
Hey, Jim and Deborah, congratulations. I hope you like the sounds of Jessica on your video, on your wedding video.
Wonderful, thank you.
One time crying and one time laughing.
Pardon me? Here you go. Sheriff.
Sheriff?
Speak.
What do I say has it already been said? I tell you, I was remembering the first time I ever crossed through here, and I would have never dreamed that my sister would get married at this very spot. It was unbelievable, but I'm real happy, and I look forward to seeing many years of Jim and Deborah together.
Amen. Thank you. Okay, speak.
About what, Deborah?
I mean, this is their tape.
Okay.
Speak to Jim and Deborah.
Oh, I hope y'all are really happy and that everything is great. And I hope I get a nephew or a niece.
There you go. Good word.
Okay.
Jeremy, what you gonna say to him?
Hey, Jim. It's great to be here. Just hope best to you guys. Just felt like God has just a tremendous call on you, your life. And I was sitting in the wedding ceremony and I was just thinking, and I really felt like one thing God said is just not to make anything too small. I feel like there's going to be a lot of missions and overseas work for you guys. So just pray, pursue it, and I just pray the blessing of God all over you guys.
Good deal. Good deal.
Jim, I really just bless you, and it's really just great to be here today. I think about the days that when we were in Moultrie, and you and Jeremy and Stephen and Adam and Anna were so little and so precious to us, and it's just really great to see you do so well, and really proud of you. Wish you the absolute best.
And they never beat us in football or baseball, right?
You know what? That is true. You never beat us. You know, there were a couple times when it was close, but you never got there. But that's okay. There are other things that are more important. We're close.
Thank you. Okay, you want to speak to Jim and Deborah?
Yes. Jim and Deborah. Congratulations. I love you guys. You exude happiness, joy, peace, prosperity, and you're going to be really blessed because it took like 20 minutes to bless you during the ceremony. So, bye.
Want to say something, Jim and Deborah?
I'm so happy for y'all. Congratulations. Married life is great, and y'all are just about to find out. We wish you lots of love. Hey! Lots of love and lots of happiness, and congratulations. We're very happy for you.
Hey, guys. Good luck, man. Beautiful wedding. Hope you have a good time on the honeymoon, and it only gets better.
Okay, thank you.
That's right.
Tim, you made it, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
You want to say something to Jim and Deborah?
Yes, sir. Jim and Deborah, I'll be praying for your marriage forever. Hello, Jim. Hello, Deborah. Hey, may the Lord bless you with the cattle on a thousand hills, and may your children's children dwell in the house of the Lord forever. God bless you, and we love you.
Ditto.
Okay, Mr. Johnson.
What? Well, congratulations. I'm still trying to get used to this. Friends that are married.
Okay, what you got to say to Jim and Deborah? If it's not good, I'm going to put the light on you now.
Best wishes.
Okay, thank you.
I love you both.
Would y'all like to say something to Jim and Deborah?
Of course. Jim and Deborah, best wishes, many happy years together.
Man, and who's this? Your daughter?
This is my daughter.
It's like me. I my daughter too, you know. If I said, you know, are these your two daughters? Yeah.
Yeah, both of them. Congratulations.
Is that your daughter?
Back here.
Yeah. And who are you?
Linda Brown. I'm from Stroud. I'm part of the
family. One of them. And who's this gentleman?
That's my husband.
Tom Brown.
And where'd y'all come from?
Marion, North Carolina.
Glad you're here. You want to say something beautiful to Jim and Deborah?
Well, this is the best of both of them. We made a lovely couple.
Thank you.
I don't know. Technically, them and them might be home. That's not how it is.
Would you like to say something to Jim and Deborah since the camera's in your face?
I guess so. Hold on, Holly. Jim and Deborah, I just love you guys. This is the most beautiful ceremony, and I know God will bless your marriage because he's blessed you with each other, and I know this can only follow, and I just, you know, wish you prosperity and long life.
Jim and Deborah, I'm so happy for you. I love you both, and it was a beautiful wedding, and I hope you have the best life together because you deserve the best. And I guess I'll see you when you have your first child.
Yes.
James, how you doing, old buddy?
I am fine. Would you like to say something to Jim and Deborah?
I already did, but
I didn't get that on camera.
Beautiful wedding. They're wonderful young people. And we're going to bathe them in our prayers daily. And hopefully they're going to come by and see old Grandpa from time to time.
And bring some great grandkids.
And James, let's don't rush it now. I want her to finish school this year.
I agree with that one, too.
Finishing in 3 years so she could do this caper here this early.
That's right.
Now, Jim's already, you know.
Yeah. Now, who's this gentleman?
This is,
I don't know,
Larry Shelf.
You better put the light on him.
Friends I ever had.
Oh, oh, oh.
Oh, my.
Yes, sir. We've been friends to Gay and Jean for ever since they've been here.
Yeah.
Yes.
And now you're talking about somebody that can sing. This brother can do it.
Wonderful.
Oh, my.
I'm telling
you. Glad y'all are here.
Well, thank you very much.
We might get him to lift a tune. Yeah,
let's do it.
This is my first wife right here, Georgia.
Oh, there's Jean.
We're proud of us, though.
We're gonna make that.
Well, Deb wouldn't remember who I am. Joyce, Larry Shaw, my husband Larry.
Oh, she'll remember.
You think so?
Yeah, she'll remember. She don't need an introduction at all.
A beautiful wedding, Deb. Thanks for inviting us. We just pray God's blessings upon both of you. We love you.
And here's Dad.
Hey, my buttons are coming undone here. I popped my buttons over that wedding.
That's why you wear suspenders.
Yeah.
When all else fails.
Do you know? How's it going?
Right.
Are they going to do the bouquet and the,
Yeah.
What are they doing?
The trip itself.
Thank you.
everybody dance.
There he is, playing in the now.
Watch Anna.
For him, it's okay. No cheating.
Okay, now what I'm going to do, Deborah, I'm going to count to three, okay? I want you to go one, I'm going to go one, two, three. Throw it on three. Okay?
Y'all ready?
Yeah!
Here we go. One, two, three.